So basics again, and we're going, I feel like I'm stealing all of Andy's absolute favourite methods here, but it just comes down to where we're sat today and the bait that I pretty much had in the fridge. And today we're going to talk about worms. I mean, lovely, lovely bait. Something I don't use very often, if I'm completely honest, but when it comes to catching a bit of everything, I'd say worms is probably the bait, isn't it? The most versatile bait of all that catches everything. If you'll excuse me for a minute, I'm just going to go murder this rooster that's doing my brain in. But I'll be back in a minute now. Joking aside, worms, absolutely wonderful bait for catching everything. But got to be done in the right way. It's quite a tricky bait that if fed, he's doing me head in, Rich. He just keeps shouting at me. So if fed in the wrong way when it comes to worms, they can be, you can mess your peg up a bit, definitely. You've got to think about what you're doing. So we're going to split this into two separate videos. And today we're going with deeper water worm fishing. So whenever you're faced with anything, what am I going to say, 3 foot? Yeah, 3 foot. 3 foot plus. Open water. I mean, what I do basically today, sort of down the middle, short, in that deeper water, that's what I'm focusing on. Anywhere from, 3 to 6 foot. I mean, lovely way of feeding worms, catching a bit of everything. So, as with always, it has got to be the riggy bit first. And keeping things simple, I've just chucked this rig onto this top kit. Again, elastic is entirely up to you. Yeah, when it comes to worms, you could literally be fishing for perch that big or carp that big, suited to the venue. Simple as it comes to worms. It's such a versatile bait. I'm noticing it a lot now. It's like proper, I can hear it all the time now. Mad rooster going on today at Cudmore. Elastic, again, needs to be suited to the type of venue that you're fishing, obviously. But the rig itself, the great thing about rigs when it comes to fishing worms is they can be mega, mega positive and a lot stronger than you'd use for certain other baits, even for little fish. So when it comes to float sizes, I want to keep things really, really simple. Say deep water we're focusing on. So we're going to go, 6 foot. No, I'll go a bit deeper just in case because we have the odd weird venue. I'm going to say 6 foot plus, 6 to 8 foot, 4B18s or sort of a 0.75, 0.8 float, big float. Once we get a little bit shallower, once we get to the depth that I'm concentrating on today, 6 foot to, I'm going to say 6 foot to 4.5 foot. Yeah, 6 foot to 4.5 foot, 4B16s, yeah, or a 0.5, 0.6 float. Yeah, depending on which float you have, obviously, what they take. When it gets a little bit shallower and I'm sort of 4.5 foot less, say in today's case, we're a little bit less, where are we, 4.5 foot, so I'm pretty much on my limit today, 4.5 foot, 4.14s. I'll use a 4.14s from 4.5 down to 3 foot. So it's not a rig I need to be nice and fluttery and delicate through the water. Yeah, it is a set your trap, put your bait on the bottom, fish over it. I mean, it's not going to be a bait. In today's case, how I want to show you how I'm fishing worms, when I'm fishing worms exclusively sort of thing, I'm not fishing them over the top of another line. I want stability. I want really heavy rigs. So yeah, today I've got a 4.14, so in our case, a 0.4 that takes plenty of shot, keeps my bait exactly where I want it. And again, the same sort of standard float that we use so often. Yeah, an elongated rugby pole pattern. In this case, one of our carbon slims. In that case, with a decent bristle on as well. Slightly heavier bristles than the norm, often a sort of 0.5 and above bristle, 0.5 up to 2 mil even, you can get away with a decent bristle on this, and you want to leave a bit out as well. So with worms, it's the one bait that I leave a bit of bristle going on. I'll leave half a bristle instead of dotting it all the way down. So I've shot my float to give a little bit more bristle. So really simple, as I say, in this case, 0.4 carbon stem float, decent length of line between float and the pole, as I do with all me on the deck fishing, and make things comfortable. If there's wind, I want to be able to hold my pole still, keep it nice and accurate without fear of moving my float because of ultra short lashes, length of line between the float and the pole. I don't want any of that with this. Yeah, so nice symbol, what we're going to say there, probably 15 inch with a back shot right in the middle of it. Yeah, very similar way to fish all my standard deep rigs on the bottom, just a single number 8 right in the middle of my rig that cannot be incorporated into the float shot in without sinking my pole. Yeah, that sort of made sense. So yeah, back shots on, all good to go. I've got me one fine tuner, which I always have. You've seen me speak about this a billion times before. Whenever it comes to fishing on the bottom, I never ever mark my pole for the depth. Yeah, spoke about this a billion times. I have one fine tuner just underneath, or multiple fine tuners on occasion. In today's case, one number 11 cube, and that's there to mark my depth and to get my bristle right. So if I want my bristle to pop up a bit, I'll take that 11 off, swap it for a 12, vice versa if I want to dot my float down a bit, or I might add multiples down there. I'll often have several fine tuners underneath my float to say, to mark my depth and to get my bristle just how I want it, but always cubes. So that'd be a right, nice little tip for that. It's always cube, stock type shots for that, because you can take them off so much easier. So coming down, line really, really nice and positive on this one. I don't need to think about it. I'm looking at the wrong camera, Rich, you're shouting at me. Line I need to be nice and positive with this one. There's no need for nice little fine lines to say. It's about keeping a straight rig, keeping things tight. So main line on this one, 016. More than happier to go to 018, nice and heavy if I need to, if there's a lot more carp at the venue I'm fishing. And bottom end, again, as simple as it possibly comes. Yeah, I'm fishing on a flat bottom 9 times out of 10. I'm getting my bait down, there's no fuss. And you could possibly get away with a solid bulk, but I'm not a fan of having just a complete block of shot. So instead, I just spread it out slightly. So with it being a 0.4 float, really simple shot in, 6 number 9 to me. 6 number 9s plus the fine tuners under me float, get it absolutely perfect. So obviously, that's with the float I'm using. Please don't take it exact that that's what they take. All floats, depending what you're using, are a little bit different either way. But as a basic rule, 4.14s or a 0.4, about 6 number 9s. Yeah, with most floats that you're going to use. And I've literally got them an inch apart. Yeah, starting on top of me 4-inch hook length. So always a 4-inch hook length for me when I'm fishing on bottom with worms. Talk about that in a minute. But literally my first shot is right on top of the knots, and then I've got little inch gaps in between each one. No taper, just spread out, nice, simple, straight on shot in that gets it down, keeps it where I want it with a slight curve in my rig, but only a slight curve. It's all about keeping it over that trap. Very, very similar to hard pellet fishing, if I'm honest. And if I'm putting my trap down on the bottom, getting it where I want it, there's no messing about. So, and lastly, of course, the bottom end and hooks. Always erring on the large when it comes to this. Yeah, I put a slightly smaller one in today's case because we're catching lots and lots of silvers today. But when it comes to worms, big hooks are definitely the way to go. Yeah, the absolute minimum is going to be what I've got today is a 16. So 16 hook, more than happy to put a 14 on. Again, depending what hook you're using, they all vary slightly in the sizes, but a 16 or a 14, absolutely perfect. Something nice and durable. And today's case, I've got a no. What have I put on? I put no 14 hook length on. Again, catching a bit of everything, even for small fish, for small silvers, a bit of everything, more than happy to fish. Probably 014 is the lightest I'd go. Yeah, there's no need to go really light on this. The type of method, you can get away with much more positive rigs. So 014, 016 with a great big hook, absolutely beautiful. And what I'm going to do with that is when it comes to hooking me worms, I have my little tub of worms, I'm going to, which one's going to be the victim? We're going to just pick a nice little one. Yeah, and I'll go with two ways. Andy's done this with you lots and lots. And I'll either nick the head of a worm nicely, just in the pointy end there, and I'll cut it off to leave myself with a lovely little maggot substitute sort of thing. So I'll often put that sort of thing on if I'm catching lots and lots of little small fish on it. Or alternatively, if I go for the other end of the worm, what I want to do is just nip the, what are they going to call it, the saddle sort of thing off. So it's right in the saddle. Get rid of that worm again. And it may be a case of putting it inside the worm, out the side, if I want a much bigger, more dormant piece. So a lot less active that than the wiggly head piece that I may put on. But there for me, for catching a bit of everything, as I say, for not being too selective with a too big a bait, are my two ways of putting a worm on. So, but I'm more than happy. You can see with that big snotty bait the way it is, you could easily get away with a 14 in today's case and catch plenty of fish. So rigs and hooking pretty much done. What I want to pay attention to is, say, this is deep water worm fishing, or deeper water, say that 3 foot plus. If I'm completely honest, on a commercial, yes, you could just chop some worms up and dump them in. It's not the way I'd want to go, because your bait's going to spread out a lot. You're going to lose a lot of the attraction. You're going to lose a lot of the goodies because your bait's going to go all over the place and get diluted in the water. You're not going to be trying to maintain the accuracy that you could potentially do. So I think it's really, really important. Let's let this car whiz past, and I'm just gonna chop these worms up a slight little bit more. Is this car coming or is he stopping? He can't make his mind this one. So what I've done is I've murdered some worms. There it go, just a little handful. Yeah, only for photograph purposes. Don't need to do too many. I've missed one, it was bothering me. That's literally one handful of worms in there, really, really simple. And what I've also got is some crushed pellet ground bait. In today's case, it's just Power Scopex. This is very, very heavily wetted. Yeah, it's really claggy, really sticky. You can see it's not a soft, fluffy mix. I've really, really over-wetted that, made it quite heavy, and I'm actually gonna add a bit more water to it in a second. So what I'm gonna do is get my separate tub, Yeah, literally put however many worms I want to feed. So a big clump of worms, that's going to be absolutely plenty. And then what I'm going to do is put one handful of ground bait to it, and also a little tiny bit of water. Because what I want to make is a lovely stodgy mix. So a little bit of water to that, that's to ground bait that's already pretty much overwetted. And I'm going to give that a nice little wiggle around, and I'll end up with a black stodgy mix, or a very dark stodgy mix. So with the added soil in the ground bait. And you can see that now gives me a lovely overwetted heavy mix that's going to go down really, really quickly, and above all else, really accurately. It's not going to cloud up because it's still stodgy. Yeah, I'm going to cup that in. It's going to go in nice in a nice ball, but break down really quickly when it's on the bottom. But the lovely attractiveness is going to still release all them juices, all the attractions of the worms, while still having lots of sexy bits of worm within the ground bait that them fish are going to home into. They make it really, really easy to fish over. So you literally, every cast or every other cast, you can go in with a nice small pole-mounted cup, that flipping rooster, and still, you're just putting your nice little ball of worms in every single go, catching whatever you can over it and repeating every single cast. So really lovely way of fishing. Everything eats it. The nicest, simplest day's fishing in the world, just with half a bag of ground bait and a big handful of worms. So well worth a go. Next time you want a lovely day's fishing. Right, you lot, very, very sorry to interrupt your video watching.
How dare you?
Quickly, if you haven't already noticed, that we have managed to write a book, haven't we?
Yes, we have,
which
Jamie.
Which is full of all our very bestest methods and features or whatever else we do on this wonderful subject of fishing. So if you haven't had a look already, go and have a look at winningways.shop and buy one for yourself.